So welcome to Howard County on behalf of County Executive Kittleman and Fire Chief John Butler. He wanted to be here, but he's traveling, not able to be here. Thanks for coming. And just wanted to walk through a few things real quick before I turn it over to Tom Gorman. So history of the fire code here, we're currently operating under the 2006 NFPA 1, which will soon change June 14th. It was adopted by the county council that we're going to be going to the 2015 version of the amended version of NFPA 1. So that in Howard County is under the county code 17.104 is the fire code. So if you're looking for that, that's where you would find it. There's a number of provisions that we have in this code that are new. It's been almost 10 years for us to update the fire code. So there's some new things that we added. We added mobile food vendor inspections is coming online. We added, obviously, the contractor portal, which we'll talk about. We also added hazmat permitting that's coming online. Probably be close to January or so for that. And then also tire inspections and tire permits, places to store outside tires. So there are some new things that we added to our fire code. So the contractor portal is going to be live after today. You will be able to access it and be able to utilize it. It will actually go live July 1st of this year. So July 1st, we expect the contractors to start utilizing the contractor portal to report your maintenance, your annual maintenance, inspections, and repairs of systems. So fire detection systems, fire suppression systems, all that will need to be reported through that. Is Dave Rines, Dave, please stand up. So Lieutenant Dave Rines in the back of the room is the project manager for the contractor portal. He's who you were asked to RSVP through. And so he will continue to be the contact for that. Also, any questions, if you have a pen and paper in front of you, the general number for Howard County, for the Fire Marshal's office is 410-313-6040. So if you have any questions about that, about any provisions of this, you can give us a call. Also, the website, www.hcdfrs.org is the fire department's website. On that, you will find the fire marshal in a couple different areas. There is an about section on the website that takes you to the fire code, and then there's a for community site that'll take you to any questions that you might have for the fire marshal. And also, Tom will give you an email in his presentation that if you have any questions or you need to respond back, that's the best way to get a hold of us, because that lasts out to multiple people that can answer your question quickly. There will be a fee for reporting. So in this contractor portal, we know that this is something that's growing nationwide. And there will be a fee for that here in Howard County. It'll be a fee of $5 per system to record it through the contractor portal. That's a divided fee. Portion of that's going to the vendor, Mobilize, and a portion of that's coming to us. And that's a very nominal fee compared to others. And, you know, I know the state of Maryland has just gone under contract to do it in state buildings with another vendor, and their fee is $10. We have another jurisdiction on the Eastern Shore that's using another vendor that they charge $10 for the fee to that company plus an additional $30 to them. Another jurisdiction in the state charges $50 per system. So we feel like we wanted to stay at a low fee, but there is some administrative costs, obviously, for us to have it with the contractor with Mobilize, but there's some administrative costs for us as well. So I just wanted to touch base on that. Also, just want to say that really our primary thing here is we're being advocates for the owners of businesses and for the visitors and stuff at those businesses. That really we want their building to be in full compliance up to the fire code, all the systems to be in compliance and all that. But we also want to make sure that they're being treated fairly by us from the fire marshal's office, from you as contractors, and stuff, that they're being treated fairly. So we will be watching that and overseeing that as we go along. I do want to mention that this is only for annual maintenance, inspections, and repairs. Any new system that's going in will still go through our permitting process through the Department of Inspections, Licensing, and Permits, and that will continue to go through that route. They will continue to do the reception, the approval testing for the initial system. So they'll go through that. That will continue to be done by their department. This is only for the annual maintenance moving forward. So we companies that we want to capture on this, I really appreciate the number of companies that we have represented here today. Our companies that are obviously licensed in the state for sprinkler work, electrical work for fire alarm and stuff, and is who we're looking for. We know we've got a number of people, fortunately, joining us on the web, and we appreciate that. The number RSVP'd and said they would be watching via live stream. So I appreciate our techs being able to do that for us today. So we know we have a number of companies represented, but we know that there's still going to be companies that we need to get to. And we will get to them as we're out there doing our annual inspections of buildings. We will get to them by knowing who does the fire alarm system, who does the sprinkler system, and the work in those buildings. So I'm not going to start off with a hammer saying, you know, demanding, but yes, we want you to start utilizing the system as of July 1st. And as we go along, those companies that aren't utilizing, we'll discover who they are and make sure that they're cooperating and participating. If you don't, there is a potential for getting NOVs and a potential for receiving a citation by way of the county code, through the county code, for not complying for the contractors. I think those are most of the topics that I wanted to hit on. I'm sure that there will be questions that come up during Mobile presentation, and we will make sure that we will answer those. Any questions that I can't answer immediately, I will certainly get back to you. So I might ask you to leave your email with me and provide the question back. And we have most of your emails that you responded back, RSVP'd. So any questions that I can't answer here, I will try to blast back out to that group. Some of the things that we are looking to make sure that get reported, and Tom will go through this more than I will, but certainly we're looking for fire alarms, sprinklers, fire pumps, kitchen hood systems, standpipes, not as frequently, but still need to be reported, private hydrants, other suppression, you know, clean agent, stuff like that. We're looking for all that to be reported through this contractor portal. We anticipate today to take probably an additional hour and a half or so. If you have additional questions, certainly ask them. Like I say, I'll try to answer as many as I can. If I can't, then we'll provide those answers to everybody. But I believe that is pretty much, am I missing anything from guys from my crew? Miss anything? So if you see the kind of the black and tan, that's our typical fire marshal. I unfortunately have to wear the, not unfortunately, I'm proud of the uniform, but would like to be more relaxed sometimes. So anyhow, I think that's it for me. I'm going to introduce, we've been utilizing Mobileye in our system for about 5 years, and we've turned on different portions. They have a very robust system for the inspection program. And as we've gone through the years, we've turned on different portions of what they can offer to us. We were excited when we saw that they had this offer. We've been looking nationally at the trend to go towards this and really wanted to be out in front to make sure that the buildings and the public is in a safe place. So we appreciate moving forward with our partnership here with Mobilize and going through the contractor portal. So I'm gonna turn it over to Tom Gorman, and I appreciate his hard work that he's been doing with us. So welcome, Tom.
Thank you, Dan. Morning, everybody. I'll give you a little bit of background about the company and what we do, not long, because I don't want to see people snoring and snoozing and heads hitting tables, but a little bit so you understand what we do. And then the primary purpose for this morning is to walk you through what is really a mini training session on how to do what Chief Merson wants you to do. So as I go through that, feel free to, you know, raise your hand, stop. Whenever you have a question, you don't need to write it down and hold it till the end. Just stop, we'll handle the questions, move on to the next step. So I'm gonna show you the process start to finish of taking an ITM report that you've got and then submitting it to the Howard County Fire Marshal's office through the contractor portal. So our company, which is actually called Trademaster, the brand name of our software is called Mobilize. But our company started in 2002. We started in the manufacturing industry, actually, doing shop floor software, maintenance, troubleshooting, parts management, things like that. And then through a number of circumstances, got into supporting AHJs and their inspection programs. So we've been doing that now, really as a full-time business, since probably 2008. And on top of that, we have two other markets that we serve. We serve the building department market, so new construction, permitting, plan review, field inspection. And then we also service your market. So we have software for contractors as well to do the kinds of inspections we're going to be talking about submitting to the Howard County Fire Marshal today. I'll mention a little bit more about that at the end of the training session. But that's really what we do. We started with the contractor portal to link the contractor community and the AHJ in mid-2014. And we did that because a large customer of ours, the city of Indianapolis, asked us to. They were looking at a couple of other companies that do this. One is Bricer, the other is iRoll. You've probably heard of these companies. And the big disadvantage to going with one of those services for the Indianapolis Fire Department is there's no integration between what's being submitted by you and the actions that the Fire Marshal's office needs to take. So how do they sort through the hundreds of reports that come in to find the few that need action now? And then how do they then take that action? How do they dispatch a DFM, a deputy fire marshal, out to the scene to make sure that those deficiencies that you find are fixed? So we put this together, not only working with the Indianapolis Fire Department, but also working with the Indianapolis area contractors. So we met several times with the Alarm Association and with the Sprinkler Association in Marion County, Indiana. And we walked through designs of what we planned to do and we took their input into account. Their primary purpose in meeting with us and their primary input was make the process simple, make it fast. So we've tried to do the best job we can to get the Fire Marshal's office what they need to act and at the same time make it fast and simple for you. So hopefully you will think that it is fast and simple, but that's been our intent. Once they started up with this program in January of 2015, come March of 2015, I actually met with those two contractor associations in Indianapolis to get feedback. You know, how do they like, is it fast enough? Are there any changes they want made, that kind of thing? We did make a couple changes, but the thing that surprised me is that when a contractor would stand up in that meeting and say, hey, look, why do we have to pay for this? You know, I mean, that doesn't make sense. Another contractor would stand up and say, hey, I don't know about you, but I've got stuff fixed that has gone 2 and 3 years without getting fixed. So there were contractors defending this that, hey, we were actually getting customers to act when they weren't acting before. So hopefully that will be your experience. Anecdotal evidence from Indianapolis, but hopefully that'll be your experience too. So before I get into the mechanics of how this thing works, do you guys have any general questions about what it's all about, our role in it versus Howard County's role, and so forth? All right, let's get into the mechanics then. All of what I'm going to show you, by the way, is available in a series of 1 to 3 minute videos once you create an account and log on to this website anyway. So don't feel like you have to take copious notes on how to go through this process. Plus, hopefully it's going to be simple enough where you don't have to take any notes. So the first thing you're going to do is create an account on the portal. So the way you do that is to go to the Mobilize website, and that is mobile-eyes.com. Even though it says .us.com up here, you can write mobile-eyes.com. Once you get there, it'll be pretty obvious where to click to log in. So you're going to click that button. You'll get to a screen that won't be so obvious. It'll have a number of log-on buttons. You are the inspection portal. That's where you want to go. And Chief Merson may actually get a link put on their website, but for now, this is how you log on. So you click the inspection portal, you'll be taken to this screen. Since none of you will have an account already, you're going to click Create Account. And then from here, it's pretty simple and pretty straightforward and a lot like what you're used to doing for other online services. So you'll put in your email address, and then there'll be a human capture challenge to make sure it's not a bot that's trying to do this. Click Continue. It's going to check to see whether your email address is already in the contractor database and already verified. See, it's fast. All right, so when you get to this screen, this is telling you that, of course, you haven't set up an account before. So you're going to put your business name in. So I'd start to put in Gorman Fire Protection, and as I type, it's going to look in the database to see companies that are already registered. So the reason it does this is your account is going to be an individualized account. It's going to be for a person in your company. You can have multiple people create accounts, multiple people submit reports from your company, or you can have one person do it, however you want to choose to do it. If you have more than one person create an account, so you can have more than one person in the office submit reports, then they all should connect to the same company. When you get to this step, if you're the second, third person to create an account, you'll see your company name and you'll click on that button. All right, so I found Gorman Fire Protection. Click on that, and it'll use that business name and connect my account to that business. The only required fields here are the name of the person, and then the password. When you click continue after entering that information, it's going to send you an email. So this is one of the security features that we have built in to make sure that only people that belong to your company are actually privy to your information, sending reports from your company and so forth. So you can't put in an email address that's not yours, because the next step is a verification email that gets sent to you. So that'll come, in this case, to tcampo@gormanfireprotection.com. She will get that email, she'll click on a link, that'll then verify the account and allow her to get in and start submitting reports. Now, at the same time, the first person who creates an account for your company will be considered the administrator for your company on the portal. So the second, third, fourth people, anybody after that first person who tries to create an account linked to your particular company, an email will be sent to that administrator saying, so-and-so just submitted an account request connected to your company. So this also prevents other companies from setting up accounts linked to your business and seeing your customer list and so forth. So we've taken several measures to make sure that only you and your company can see your confidential information. So just to repeat, if you have multiple people setting up accounts, the first person is the administrator, and that person has to authorize the rest of the people who set up accounts before they can do anything on the portal. Let me stop and see if there are any questions about the whole account piece of this thing. So far, so good? So far, so good. All right. Let's get in then, and I'll show you the process. Okay. So this is considered the home screen, if you will. I'll kind of walk you through what's here. There's a lot of stuff going on this screen, so I'll walk you through what this is, and then we'll get into the process of actually submitting a report. So up in the upper left, you've got some account management tools up there. I'll go through what you have to do with that in a second. On the lower left, you've got help videos. So for each step in the process, each place where you might have a question, there's a video here walking you through how to do that step of the process. The videos are short, 1 to 3 minutes. This is your training for people who aren't sitting through this demonstration this morning. Up in the upper right, there's a help desk email and phone number. That's my team's help desk. Feel free to call that. We operate generally 7 to 8 at night, so 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Our official hours are 8 to 8, but generally somebody's there at 7. Feel free to call. When you call, identify yourself as a contractor, because we'll be looking through the Howard County Fire Marshal's list and looking for a deputy fire marshal with your name. We won't find him. So identify yourself as a contractor trying to submit a report to Howard County, and then we'll help you. All the middle stuff is the process of submitting reports, and then we keep track of which reports you've submitted over time, and so that's what that bottom area is. That bottom area is kind of your archive to look up these reports. All right, so up in the upper left, you see a pick box for AHJ. And that's because if you submit reports to more than one AHJ using this particular portal, you can pick from this list which AHJ you're submitting a report to. So you only need one account to submit reports to whomever you need to submit them to. When you create your account, you won't have any AHJs listed here. So what you'll need to do is click on Admin Tools, and this is your administrator who will do this, because if you have multiple accounts, the non-administrators won't be able to get in here. And then click on Associated Municipalities. When you do that, this piece is not that fast. This piece is going to take 20, 30 seconds to come up, because we're looking across all the AHJs that are using this across the country, and all the contractors that are using this across the country. So it's a fairly big database that it's kind of plowing through at this point. You'll get to a screen that looks like this. You'll have a whole big list of available AHJs on the left-hand side, Howard County being one of them, and you'll have nothing on the right-hand side because it's a new account. So you'll click on Howard County, click the arrow to push it over to the right-hand side, and that's all you have to do. So whatever on the right-hand side represents the AHJs that you submit reports to. Any questions about that step? All right, let's go back to the main menu. And then at this point in the pick list, you'll have Howard County, and that'll be your only option up there if that's the only one you've picked. So now that you've chosen Howard County, when you go to submit a report, you're going to be able to see all the addresses, all the businesses, all the buildings that are currently in the mobilized database for Howard County. So they've got all the commercial properties listed in their database. And this is one step which I hope will speed the process for you. We're not making you type all that stuff in every time. You just search and connect to the property that's in their database. Yeah? Number of the help desk up in the right is 866-974-1117. There'll be a couple of prompts, but the first one will be the help desk, so you don't have to worry about that. Okay, so let's submit an inspection. You've got reports for the day. You have to submit them to Howard County. You log on. You start by clicking Start an Inspection. You'll get to a step where you can search the database and pull up the property that you inspected. So you can search by address number, typing it in and clicking Find Matches. Or you can search by the street name. And as you search by the street name, it's going to start popping up matches to streets that are in the database itself. Click the street and it'll show you the addresses on that street. So you find the service location where the inspection was done and click Select. There's a button at the bottom if you can't find the address. If you can't find the address, first thing you should do is look at how you're searching. If you're putting in the number and the street, get rid of the street, just search for the number. Make sure there aren't any spaces or anything like that, like after the name or something. Make sure you're searching correctly. Then make sure that the property that you did the inspection in is actually in Howard County, because that'll happen too, where you're trying to submit something to Howard County that's not in their jurisdiction. But if you're pretty sure on both those, you've searched correctly and the property's in their jurisdiction, then you click, I can't find the job site address. It'll pop up a place for you to put in the address of the service location where you did the work. So let's go back to the start. And I'll use this as our service location, click Select, move to the next step. Now, here's where there's a difference between how the Fire Marshal's office operates and how contractors operate. Most of the time, you guys don't care about who occupies the building. You're doing the work for the property management company. It can be a multi-floor, multi-tenant office building. You're inspecting the building. Howard County, on the other hand, is inspecting occupants in the building. So there's a bit of a disconnect between how they need the database set up and how you would like the database set up. So you're going to see in this step occupants in the building. Okay? In this case, it's easy because it's a single tenant structure. It doesn't really matter who the tenant is. You can pick them and move on to submit the report. I'll show you an example in a few minutes of a multi-tenant structure and what you do about that. How do you submit it when you haven't done the inspection for any of the tenants? You've done it for the property manager who manages the building. So I'll click Select for this particular occupant. It's going to ask me whether this business still occupies the space. That's just because the fire marshal's office may not have been out there recently. They may not know that the property has turned over. If you know the property has turned over, click no, and it'll give you a place to put in the name of the new occupant of that space. In this case, the school is still there, so I'm going to click yes. Then the fire marshal's office would like to know who your main contact is. Is it one of the contacts they've already got in the database, or is it somebody else? Because a lot of times, like I said, you're working for the property management company, which is not their main contact when they do their inspections. So if one of these is my main contact, I'm going to select them. If not, I can say I can't find the contact. It'll ask me for a name and a phone number. That's it. All right, so now we get down to the nitty-gritty. Once you've found the service location, gone through those other couple of steps, it's going to ask you for the date that you did the inspection. Not today's date, but the date that the inspection was actually done. And that's important because the fire marshal's office is going to track people's compliance with annual, semi-annual, quarterly, well, not quarterly. You're not getting quarterlies, but semi-annual and annual inspections. So make sure to put the accurate date when the inspection was done. So if it was done today, you can click today. That'll populate the date. If you're submitting the report after the fact, use the pop-up calendar to pick the date. The system types that are listed in this list are the types that Chief Merson wants you to submit reports for. So you may see this list change. If he changes his mind on what he wants reported, you'll see this list change. But for now, that's it. So you'll see that you can check off more than one system type. That's so you can submit, if you went out to a building, like you're a combination company, and you went out and did the pump test, the annual sprinkler inspection, and the annual alarm inspection all in one day, you can submit all three of those together. And that doesn't cost you 3 times 5, it costs you 5. So inspections done on the same day submitted together are a single submittal fee. So I'll say that my company inspected the sprinkler system and the alarm inspection. It'll ask me if we found deficiencies. So I'll say yes on both. There's a general notes field here. If you have something to report to the fire marshal, feel free to put a note in there. Other than that, you don't have to. Any questions about this screen before I move on? Mm-hmm. The question was if you subcontract, let's say you're a sprinkler company and you sub out the alarm report, right? I'll give that to you, Dan.
I would say that could be, I guess, ultimately reported from you through the portal, but we're going to come back to your company because a subcontractor is working for you, correct? So I would say it comes from you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions about this step? Yeah?
Can you go back to your comment about annual versus semi-annual or quarterly? Is the fire marshal only tracking annual inspections?
Yes, primarily annual with the exception of like kitchen hood systems, which need to be semi-annual. So semi-annual for those, and then like for the sprinkler systems and stuff, we're only tracking the annuals for that.
So if your system goes in May and the annual
inspection starts in July, and your annual is in May,
you would only be required to file the first annual
inspection. When it's due, that's correct. Now, by the way, the fee portion, this is not going to kick in till July 1st. So if you want to get on and start submitting reports. The fire marshal encourages you to do that. The fees won't kick in until July 1st. Question? Hold on one sec there. We're going to do the Oprah thing and get you a mic. Cars.
If an inspection takes longer than one day, the same inspection, is that two separate inputs, or is that one longer? Say it's a larger building, mm-hmm. takes 3 days to do the inspection on fire alarm system.
You're producing a single report, right?
Single report.
Yeah, one submittal.
So it doesn't matter that it's all completed on one day.
No, I mean, from our company's perspective, we consider the inspection, in our contractor inspection software, we consider the inspection date or the date of record to be the date you started the inspection.
Very good.
Dan, do you want to add anything to that? All right, so a couple steps left. It's going to ask you at this point for the systems you inspected where you found deficiencies. It's going to ask you how severe were the deficiencies. And the reason it asks you that is because this is kind of the triage portion of the system that helps the fire marshal determine which follow-ups to do, which buildings to send a DFM out to see whether they fix these things. And they have different rules set up in the portal on how these are processed. More severe inspections might get processed immediately, while inspections with less severe deficiencies get put on a review screen for a human to actually take a look at before they get processed into the database. More severe deficiencies might trigger a text message to the fire marshal so that he can dispatch a DFM out that same day, if it's an impairment, let's say, that same day to follow up and make sure progress is being made. So that's why we're asking you to just select how severe of a deficiency or deficiencies did you find. If you have a mix of deficiencies, obviously the most severe is what you put here. So for the sprinkler system, I'm going to say I've got critical deficiencies, or for the alarm system, critical, for the sprinkler, non-critical. Question? Yes, the question was, is it up to the contractor to determine the level of deficiency? This is a really interesting question, because when we designed this back with Indianapolis and all their contractors, that was one of the big points of discussion. Well, aren't you going to get like variation across the board? One people think this is severe, somebody else thinks this is an impairment, et cetera. And it, for the most part, I stayed out of it. You know, it wasn't my deal to get into. But what they settled on was, look for sprinklers, look at the NFPA 25 examples. So we put a link to those on that page. So these are the NFPA 25 examples of severe, critical, and non-critical deficiencies. And then for alarms, there's an extensive document they put together. There you go. There's your help. So this. Yeah, I think for the Howard County Fire Marshal, if you all have an association or something that you belong to that you would like to come up with more guidelines for this, just pass those on to Dan. He can put those in like you see here, so the guidelines are there for everybody. Any other questions at this step? I'll repeat the question, and then you can answer that one, Chief. The question was, what if you, the contractor, determines one level of severity the fire marshal or deputy fire marshal gets out, they see the situation, they determine it's a different level of severity.
And what we'll do in that case is we'll follow up with you as the contractor to show what our determination was, and if we need to come back and adjust some of the examples, then we would do that.
Yeah, so as long as everybody understands that the boxes you're checking here determine action that the fire marshal's office is going to take. You know, generally, a non-critical deficiency is not going to get necessarily a follow-up inspection scheduled, but a critical or an impairment certainly will get notifications out, will get a DFM following up and going out to that business. All right, since we're not requiring you to type in the results of your report, we're allowing you to just say what level of severity the deficiencies were. The deputy fire marshal, when he or she goes out there to follow up, needs to know the specifics of the deficiency. So we've opted to have you just upload your report with the submittal as opposed to making you type in what you found. Contractors have said this was a preferable option. So you'll click that button and then attach your reports. So you click the browse button, attach the report. If you've inspected more than one system and are submitting those reports together, attach both reports. This function of uploading and attaching the report will take up to a 10 meg file. It'll compress stuff. So if you have a bigger file, it'll try to compress it to get it below the 10 meg limit. If you start doing this and you see that it's rejecting your reports because they're too big, look at your scanner. If you're scanning in paper reports, look at your scanner and see what level of resolution. What level of resolution your scanner is set to, set it at a lower level of resolution and it'll produce a smaller file. There's also a link here. You see that blue link, you probably can't see what it says, but there's a little blue link right there. That goes to a website where you can upload your electronic file. It will compress it for you and you can download it back. So you can try doing that too. All right, so at this point, this is kind of your review step, shows you the service location, the occupant, if you will, that you submitted the report against, what inspections you're submitting, and the level of severity for each one. At the bottom, you have a couple of options. If you just want to pull the trigger at this point, you click Submit Inspection. If for some reason you want to hold this and submit it later, you click Main Menu. It'll sit there in a holding bin until you decide to submit it. If you want to email a copy to somebody, you can email that using that button. For the most part, you're going to click Submit Inspection at this point. And that's the process, straight through, simple example. You found the address, single occupant building, you submitted the reports. I'm gonna go through two or three other examples on how you deal with different kinds of addresses that'll be in their database when you see them. But on the straightforward process, any questions on that? Yes, so the question was, if there are no deficiencies, do you have to attach the report, right? I would say yes, you still want to see the report. It's going to be part of their data. Part of the value of this is that they now have a full history on that building. You know, they know not only when they were out there, they know when you were out there, they've got a copy of your report in the database, the whole thing. Other questions?
Wait,
We are monitoring maintenance and repair tickets as well. So maintenance, repairs, and annual inspections is what we're looking at.
Based on the annual inspection or a supplement?
Could be.
Okay, so let's take ABC Company has an air compressor that just stopped working. They call under repair. We're not doing an inspection, but we're doing a repair. Is that a separate entry? Is that?
It would be a separate entry, same address and stuff, but it would be an entry that you're correcting something.
I don't think I've seen anything for the service.
I'm sorry?
I don't believe I've seen anything for the service.
There isn't anything labeled service. So let's take the example where you go out and do an annual inspection, you find deficiencies, the company hires you to come back, do the service work, fix things. So the question is, how do you inform them that those deficiencies that you already reported are now fixed and they don't need to go back out and follow up? That, it would be really great if you could submit those through this portal without getting charged. But you can't right now, because we don't have that functionality, and that'll come shortly. So for now, we have an email address for you. Let me pop that up so you can see it. This is the email address you're supposed to send those follow-ups to. Okay, can you get that? That's got to be big enough, right? So copy that down. Again, that's for if you're doing an inspection, find deficiencies, you do the repairs, those deficiencies are now fixed. You can send a follow-up email to that address, not have to go through the portal, not have to pay to pass go, and everything's good.
I think primarily just refer back to the address and what the problem was, and that the correction has been made is all we would need. So we would need to link all that together. So good point. Yep. Date, location, that the problem's corrected.
Yeah, I would think too, if you've submitted more than one system report, you want which system this is for. Like in my case, I submitted sprinkler and alarm. Are all deficiencies fixed on both? Did you just clear the alarm system? Right here and then back there.
Once you submit that, then everything is in, whether it's that inspection or repair. When we go back to that customer that we've entered into our system, will we be able to see everything that we have sent you?
Yeah, let me show you how that. Yeah, I'll show you how that works, and then don't let me forget to come back and show you a couple of these oddball situations that you're going to face. But let me jump over. I'll show you that. Okay, so up in the top of the screen here, you're going to see your submitted inspections. Those are going to be sitting there with the nice colorful label describing the level of severity that you've put to that inspection. So those will sit up there until the fire marshal accepts them. Okay, if we think about it in those terms. So depending on how the fire marshal has set it up, they may flow right in automatically and you may not see it in this upper section. For example, if you submit an impairment, that's going to flow, that's going to get auto-processed, flow right through, text message the fire marshal, dispatch it, all that stuff's going to happen like now, right? So it won't be in the top. You submit something with no deficiencies or non-critical or in this case critical deficiencies, it'll go on a review screen and it will sit up in this area of your portal account until the fire department imports it into the database, okay? So once the fire department imports it in, I don't have one to show you actually, it's gonna go in the bottom portion of the screen, and you've got several filters there, all self-explanatory on how to go find those. in the back there?
The original question about a customer calls out of the blue for a service.
Yeah.
Is that imported through here, or do we send an email to grant service or a question?
Yeah, I think if you want them to submit the service reports, we need to add a box for service as opposed to, well, no, actually, you know what? Let us get together. Yeah, I know, exactly. Let us get together and decide. We've got the boxes for the system types, right? So you can still say it was an alarm system service report. I would say click that. We won't put another box saying service. We'll just have you click the system that you're submitting the service report on. And then there's that, remember that comments box that showed up under there? Just put in there service ticket. That's what the fire marshal said a few minutes ago. Is that? Yes, that's true.
So do we have to go back and create that customer just as we did for the original inspection? Even though it's only a service call, sometimes you call for the service and not the inspection. So you still have to go back to the beginning, create that as a client, so you have access to all the information of the system that you submit to you guys.
Yes. The question was, do you have to go through all the early steps, find the address, find the client, et cetera? You do have to do that. You know, that process flows through.
What kind of service call are you referring to?
Sometimes some buildings have, they have a preferred vendor or a corporate account, and it might be, you know, a company you can look up, maybe see. They do all their inspections, but they don't always necessarily do repairs and or service calls. They may call a local company. Mm-hmm.
Right, I mean, this is not just a list, when you're searching on this screen, it's not just a list of your clients, it's a list of every commercial address they've got in the county.
No, yeah, I understand, but I mean, you have to go through the beginning.
Go through the beginning steps. There was some other mix of questions and grumbling. So.
And the one thing I will say is that as we're going through this, it's going to be a bit of a learning process for us too. So certainly there are some things that might change or we might make a decision. You know, we don't want a whole bunch of extra steps for you all to have to do, or we don't want a lot of unnecessary fees going back on the companies that you're servicing as well. So we'll have to think through some of that as we go through the process. As we do, we'll push that out by mass email with any changes that we make. Yes, because technically, if that happened for an extended period of time, the building's occupied, we'd want to know that. We put them on fire watch and everything else. So, yes, we would want to know that scenario.
I see what you're saying. Between when the inspection was done and when you should submit it?
We certainly will work with that. Now, obviously, if there's critical problems, then we'll want to know those sooner rather than later. But certainly, we realize it's going to be a learning process for all of us, and there's going to be certainly a grace period as we work through this. And then we'll come up with a stamp, kind of a that we feel easily attained by you all.
If you submit a report with the fire marshal, what is your procedure?
primary person we're going to be getting back to is the building first. You know, the occupant, the building owner, so that, you know, if we need to put them on fire watch, if we need to follow up and have some immediate things done. So that's going to be the contact that we make immediately. And then it will be initiated with the contractor too, just to say, okay, because we'll have to lay out, you know, what time frame, for instance, that repairs might need to be made and what needs to be done during that time period. So there will be contact with both, but the immediate contact is going to be with the property owner. Sure, and there's time periods where we give extended periods of time to the property owner as they're working through, especially if it's a major cost to them, then there's time that we will allow them.
In the back?
In a case like a residential, we're talking a residential system, right? Okay. Certainly, if it's a commercial system and you're making repairs to the commercial system, we would want to know. If it's just being done on a residential side, then we're not... although we'll be following up with the residents, we're not necessarily tracking that on the residential piece. We're primarily looking at commercial. For the most part, like I say, if you're inspecting it, servicing it, and the service, I wrote that down. We'll have to kind of talk through that on how we approach that, because good examples have been brought up. But certainly inspections, maintenance of it, yeah, we're going to want to know that. Yeah, it's going to be the original charge, and then that follow-up will occur through the email address that we just put up there. Ultimately, we're working so that that'll go right into the system, again, without an additional charge. But that's going to be a little bit of, that's probably, you know, several months down the road before that's going to happen. So right now, we want that communication through the email address.
I'll walk through that.
Tom will go through that.
I think there's a question in the back. The list of deficiencies that your company cited on your inspection report?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'll tell you mechanically what happens. Mechanically what happens is the fire marshal's office gets the report from the company that submitted the inspection report in the first place. So they have the contractor's report with the list of whatever that contractor put on it, right? And then I would assume, but this isn't necessarily true, that that contractor has given a copy of that report to the customer. When you go in as a second company hired to do repairs, you're going to follow the process of submitting those repairs in. You won't know whether those are all the deficiencies that were found during the inspection or not, because you didn't do it.
Let me just hang on one second. We got word that we're not just here in this room, that we're doing a webinar as well, and they're having a hard time hearing
the questions.
So give us a second to get the mic to you, and then we'll go from there.
Do you want me to sum? I think I understand your question. So if you're a second contract company and some other company has done the inspection, you've been hired to do the repair. When you do the repair, do you have to submit the report through the portal or do you submit it through the email?
Correct.
So I'll repeat it again. So if you're the company hired to do the repair, but you didn't do the initial inspection, can you submit the report for the repair to the email address or do you submit it through the portal like you would for any other repair that you've been talking about in the last few minutes or so? Because this guy's company didn't do the original inspection.
But they're working for somebody. I think that kind of goes back to her earlier question. Okay, well then help understand it then.
I think what he was getting at was that you're not the original annual inspection company. You're just a service, you're doing the service provided that they've asked you to do. So with that, you would have to then create another account because you are now the company that's providing the service, not necessarily the annual inspection. So you're not necessarily a sub for another contractor.
Right.
You're just another vendor for the owner representative and or property management.
But you're doing work on the system to bring it into full compliance.
That is correct.
So then a report would have to be completed so that we know the system is back in full compliance.
Yes.
So I think the answer to that question, and correct me if I'm wrong, but listening to the answer to the question is, if you did not do the inspection and yet you've been hired to do the repair work that results from the inspection, you submit that report through the portal. I believe that was the answer to the question. In the back.
I know from our company's perspective, if we did an inspection but did not do the repair, we would make a follow-up site visit to retest those deficiencies to clear up the actual report. So if the people that submitted the report didn't do the repair, in order to clear the report, I think that the company that did the initial inspection should revisit the site and re-inspect those deficiencies.
Now, in that particular case that the gentleman just gave, when he goes back to do the site visit, to how does he submit his report? His company did the inspection, he did not do the repair, but he's going back and doing a site visit to make sure things are fixed. How does he submit that second site visit report? Through the email. He doesn't need to submit it through the portal because he did the original inspection. The fire marshal's not going to make him pay again to submit the follow-up report. Other questions? All right, let's go through a couple last examples here just to know what you're going to see. This is going back to the difference between how they organize their data and how you would organize the data, you know, you by building, them by tenant or occupant of the building. So you're going to see some anomalies here, and this is how you deal with them. Okay, so here's, this is an example of a multi-tenant building. So you picked the service location, the address, and then you got to this step where you're supposed to pick the occupant. It's going to tell you there are multiple occupants or tenants in this building. Which one did you do the work for? You didn't do the work for any of the tenants, but you do see a tenant, if you will, called Shell, the building Shell. Whatever the name is under occupant, you can ignore that. If it's shaded at the top and it's got the word Shell to the right of the select button, that is the building. So if you did the work for the property manager on the building, pick the building Shell and submit your report. Now, if you did the work for one of those tenants, pick the tenant. All right, let's do another example. This is the same sort of example, a multi-tenant structure, but there's been no building shell created for this. You expected to see a shaded line at the top with the word shell to the right, but you don't see it. It's because not every multi-tenant structure in their commercial address database is going to have a building shell set up. There's going to be one set up because you or some other contractor created it when you're submitting a report, or because the fire marshal's office is inspecting the building exterior, the common spaces, and so forth. So they've created the building shell occupant. So in this case, when you see this building, you click the button at the top that creates the building shell. That's all you do. So you've basically created that shell so you could submit your inspection for that building. Okay, let's do a last example. All right, this is an example of multiple buildings at a particular service location or a particular address. So you can see there are two occupants there. This is probably not the best example of this because you'd just pick one of the occupants. They're both single tenant buildings. But if you could have multiple occupants in multiple buildings at this address. If that's the case, find the building shell for the building that you inspected. Or if there is no building shell, like in this case, click the button at the top to create the building shell and then submit your inspection. So those are really the variations you're going to see. You're going to have single tenant, single building addresses. You're going to have single tenant in each of multiple buildings. You're going to have multiple tenants in a building or multiple buildings. Those are the variations you'll see. Any questions on how to deal, just the mechanics of dealing with that? Great. A couple things that are coming in 2017 with this service. The fire marshal right now doesn't have the ability to auto-generate notifications to customers that their annual alarm inspection is due or their annual sprinkler inspection is due or something like that. That's one of our high priorities, to automate that process so that the customers won't know, they won't get any indication of who they should call for that. They'll just get an indicator, say 30 days prior to the date of their last inspection, that their next annual sprinkler inspection is due. So that's one of the enhancements that's coming. Another we've talked about here today, which is your ability to provide follow-up reports on inspections when you've gone back and verified that everything's fixed or you've done the fix yourself. Microphone over on the left there.
So at the bottom of this memo, it references a Class C civil action failure. Would that be for an inspection that, say, we didn't do, like an annual inspection that the next year went so far past due, it could result in a civil C for us?
Or is you as the contractor you're talking about, really reporting through this is where that applies to you all. If there's any notice of violation or anything like that, needs to be carried back to the property owner or the occupant on the actual system itself if it's not in annual compliance, not to you all. So that the piece that applies to you all is if you fail to report, if you go out and do the work and you fail to report it through the portal system, that's what that is.
Okay.
Couple last things. I talked in the beginning of the process about how the first person to create an account for your company will be the administrator for your company. All people who create an account after that will need permission from that person to do anything in their portal account attached to your company. This is the email, an example of the email that will go to the administrator when somebody else sets up or tries to create a portal account linked to your company. And then there's one last thing I want to show you. Actually, let's walk down that process. When July 1st comes, that's when the fee portion of this will kick on. It'll be processed through credit card or debit card or PayPal account right online. You'll buy however much credit you want to buy based on how many inspections you anticipate doing in a reasonable period of time. And you'll purchase that credit through the same portal. So you'll see up in the upper left, my company has $595 worth of credit. When this gets to zero, you click the link below, and it'll take you to the different quantities of credit that you can purchase. So as low as $50, as high as $500. Click on the button. That's going to take you to an e-commerce site called 2Checkout. It's not part of our company, it's just a commercially available service. You'll follow the normal process to put in your payment information, so forth, and then at the end, there is one step I want to show you here. Periodically, we get calls to the help desk of companies that have put their credit card in, gone through the purchase process, but they go back to their account and they don't have the credit there. So what has happened is they get to this last step and they don't see the orange button at the top. The orange button is what gives you your credit. So they've taken your money, but you haven't got your credit if you don't click the orange button. So if you want to write a note about that, that'll prevent angst on the part of your administrator when this kicks in. Yep. Oh, let's get the microphone. No singing.
Okay. So what if we don't have $50 worth of it? Like, we don't have that much activity in Howard County.
Right.
We have less than that.
Yeah. But we get this question periodically. We have looked at making the smallest quantity 25. I mean, this is 10 inspections, right? So there are contractors in jurisdictions that we serve where they don't do 10 inspections in a year, and so they object to paying to prepaying $50 worth of inspections. We've looked at doing that. We may drop it down to $25. For now, we haven't, because every time that we process, not us, but two checkout processes, one of these transactions, we get hit with a fee. So, you know, if you drop it down too low, we have to raise the price of the thing to cover the fees. Credits don't expire. But I understand your question. You don't want to prepay for like 3 years worth of inspections. Yeah. Any other questions?
Is this a dedicated server you maintain? Does Howard County maintain it? Does it have backup? Does it have redundant servers?
Do you want to?
Yes,
so the question was about the security of the data. Are you specifically asking about the credit card transactions?
Well, there's a whole process here. It's, I mean, I don't know about all the certifications. Has the website ever been down? We had a hurricane. We're out 5 days. Do you have backups?
Right, so overall, as far as how the like back-end architecture of this thing's set up, our company has hired many years ago a data center called Secure24. It's just a service that's located in Michigan, which is where our headquarters is. Secure24 is the data center behind all of the business that we do, including they're the host for the contractor portal. The two checkout process where you're actually buying credits, that has nothing to do with us. You can go on tocheckout.com and you can read about their certifications and all the security certificates they have and their audits and so forth. It's a commercial service like several others that you can use to do a back end like this, to process transactions. That's what we've chosen to do. We don't store any credit card information. We don't see any credit card information. All we see is credits that show up in your account. The Mobilize site, it's in Michigan. Yep. What other questions do you have?
This is more for the Fire Marshal's office. We have a client that does a lot of classified work for the U.S. government, and they are probably not going to be very happy at the idea of information on their properties being transmitted over the internet. Is there some place they can contact to discuss the matter?
You can just give them my information. They can contact me. We have a lot of DOD. We have a lot of government contractors. We have a lot of secure sites in the county. So we're very familiar with utilizing, you know, with dealing with them constantly. So sure.
I know we currently have a NASA base, a Navy base. Let's see what else. I think those are the only two impressive ones to throw your way that would be concerned with security, and they're satisfied with the arrangement. Other questions? This is live currently, so you can create an account and start submitting inspections if you want to get into it. There's no charge until July 1st. Thank you, everybody.
To once again thank Tom and his company for the work that he's done here. And just to echo what we were saying earlier, it's going to be a learning process for all of us, and there will be some, you know, grace period. And I ask for that grace for us as well, as we'll be working through it, as well as you. So I do just want to thank you for the time that you've dedicated to this morning, and I look forward to working with you as we move forward with this operation. All right. Thank you very much.